Hello, good morning. This is Breakfast with Dan Walker and Louise Minchin.
The Chancellor prepares for the first budget with an upbeat message on the economy.
There's expected to be extra money for social care, but there will be few other giveaways.
Good morning. All this week, I've been hearing from different generations about what they want from the budget. Today, we're talking to the post-war baby boomers and beyond. So I'm at a retirement village in Bournville.
Good morning, Steph.
Morning.
Good morning to you. Morning, everyone. Welcome to Bournville Gardens. So this is a retirement village near Birmingham, and there's about 300 residents who live here. So there's a real mix of different accommodation you can get here. Some of the residents we've managed to get up early this morning we'll be talking to later on. But yeah, there's a mix of one and two bedroom apartments, and you can rent or buy them. The rent costs anywhere from between £35 a week up to £135, and that all depends on your circumstances. But there's loads of facilities here. So they've got a gym, they've got an IT suite, they've got a bar and a lounge, a village hall, they've got a hairdresser's over here. So it's all about making later life more comfortable for people. So I'm going to be talking to them a little bit later on about what they want to hear from the budget. But also, Tim Muffett's been out with a walking club in North Norfolk to meet some retirees and find out what they think. Good morning to you. Morning, everybody. Yeah, this is a retirement village with a difference. It's well posh here. This is a place called Bournville Gardens. I'm in the bar bit, obviously a bit early to be getting drinks, but not too early for breakfast. So some of the residents have come down to get their breakfast here this morning. There's about 300 residents who live here, and they live in different types of accommodation, one and two bedroomed apartments mainly. But the whole point is making later life more comfortable for them. So we've gathered some of them together so we can have a chat with them about their thoughts and what they would like to hear from the Chancellor. And we've got Elaine here, who's one of the early risers this morning for us. Morning, Elaine.
Good morning, Steph.
Tell us a bit about what you would like to hear from the Chancellor.
I'm not sure I'm going to hear anything positive from the Chancellor, because he hasn't got enough money to throw around. He's going to have to rob Peter to pay Paul. But I would like to see him concentrate on social care so we don't get all the hospitals clogged up with beds that aren't being used. And there's not enough care in the home, because there's no money. But more importantly, with my grandchildren, I'd like to see them get on the housing ladder at some point. Yeah. And at this point in time, I can't see how they're going to do it.
And with the care area of things, obviously that's something which... does it worry you?
It does worry me slightly, but for other people, we are fine here, because we have saved and made sure that we've got opportunity in our old age to look after ourselves. A lot of people don't have those opportunities.
Yeah, you're quite lucky.
I feel quite lucky. Yeah, very lucky, in fact.
Yeah, Ellen, thank you very much. I'll let you finish your bacon butty. And you two stop messing around in the background. I could see you then. I know, I'm telling you. I'll be seeing you in the gym shortly, don't you worry. Putting you through your paces. We have got... They're terrible. We have got some of the guests here to talk to. Marion, who's written a book about, essentially dealing with later life. And we were hearing there, Elaine, talking about social care and about concern about her grandchildren. Give us the wider picture on this, the concerns for people in later life.
Yeah, I think Elaine's dead right that the key thing, the really serious issue here, is social care. That's in a really dire state. And I suspect that Philip Hammond will announce some kind of measures. But what we need is not just some kind of sticking plaster thing, even if it's quite a big figure. What we need is a kind of putting social care on a sustainable basis, because it's really, really important. And I think you have to separate that from other concerns that older people have. I mean, that is, I think, the really serious one. And Elaine mentioned her grandchildren and housing. I think we've come to a moment, actually, there's a certain amount of resentment in the wider population about some of the universal benefits that older people have. And I think we have to have a look at those sort of pensioner perks and think about them really seriously. Because, you know... I mean, a lot of them were introduced for no rhyme or reason, like winter fuel payment. I think some of these things have got to be means tested.
So you think that when you say think about them, you mean maybe cut back on some of them, because you think maybe older people are getting too much?
Well, the thing is that some older people are tremendously wealthy and some older people aren't. And you've got to make sure that the people who are not wealthy have got... you know, a good life. But the fact is that, you know, if you're a millionaire, you can get a winter fuel payment and your TV license if you're over 75 and so on. I think you've got to look at these things. And the key thing I'd like to see Philip Hammond look at is inheritance tax, because George Osborne in 2015 massively increased the exemption for inheritance tax, so that if you're married or in a civil partnership and you pass on your main home to your children, you get £1 million exemption from inheritance tax, which bumps up the price of housing, and it's also colossally unfair for people. So you have a massive divide between people who inherit a lot and people who don't. And as I say, you're bumping up housing prices, and that's not good for everybody, for the whole. So you bring down the threshold for inheritance tax. You let people, you know, bequeath money, but you don't give them this colossal amount, which is so damaging, and I think causes resentment too. Yeah. Yeah, but social care is the key one. We've got to have money for that.
Yeah. Marion, thank you very much. And so much more to talk about. We're going to be talking to an economist a little bit later in the programme as well, just about how this all might work. If you've got any thoughts on it as well, do get in touch, because some of the things there, Marion was saying, might be a bit controversial with you, so do let us know your thoughts on it. I'm going to get these guys in the gym now, I'm telling you. Don't be looking at me like that. Get your bacon butties finished, honestly. Steph, you were like, come on, we'll go at the gym.
I think they might give you a run for your money.
You're up for it.
Oh, he's off.
Look at that. See you in the gym later, Steph. Thank you very much.
Morning. All this week, I've been talking to different generations about what they would like to hear from the budget today. So today we're talking to the post-war baby boomers. So I've got some of them up early to talk to me. And we're here at the Bournville Gardens Retirement Village.
Steph.
Good morning to you. Morning, everybody. Yeah, welcome to Bournville Gardens. I'm in the residence bit now, but have a look over the side because you can see where we are. So this is essentially a retirement village. There are around 300 residents who live here. And if you can see, you can see some of them there. We've been chatting to some of them this morning and will be throughout the morning. But there's a hairdresser's here through one of the doors. There's a village hall where they put on events. There's a gym, IT suite, a wellbeing centre. They've got a landscape gardened area out the back and a greenhouse where they can go and work, tend to the plants and the fruit and veg in there. So it's certainly a busy place. The whole point being is to make, you know, people in later life have a bit more independence, but also have that community element to things. In terms of how much it costs to stay in somewhere like this, the rent is something like £135 a week. But if you are on benefits, it reduces and can go right down to £35 a week. So it's about bringing lots of different people with different backgrounds together, but all of those in later life, the post-war baby boomers and beyond. And that's who we're focusing on today, talking to them about what they'd like to hear from the Chancellor. So Tim Muffett went to meet some of them at a walking club in North. So there we go, some of the thoughts of the baby boomers in North Norfolk. Now we've managed to get them in the gym. You see Elaine and Tom, who I was talking to earlier, got the gym kit on, already on the machine. So we're going to be talking to experts here and to more of the residents about what they would like to hear from the Chancellor. Lots of different views, some of them concerned, obviously, about social care and the money going into that, because obviously that's something they will need in later life, and also about their grandchildren and what's going to happen to them. So it's a real kind of mixed bag, and we will be talking to them throughout the programme here. And hopefully, I mean, they're not even out of breath, are they? Look at them. Look at Tom. He's just going for it there. And watching himself on telly.
Well, that's what I'm very struck that they obviously watch I don't know how to describe that breakfast programme on the television, but I think it's excellent, Steph.
See you later.
You're watching yourself to make sure you're tails at the end, Steph, all right? You do your bit, and then I'll ask you heads or tails at the end, and we'll flip the coin, all right?
Good morning to you. Morning, everyone. We've got Tom working hard here this morning as well. What are we on now? We're on like... God, you're going for miles there. Tom, keep going. He's a fan of Carol Kirkwood, he was just telling me. Isn't everyone? But I'm here at Bournville Gardens Retirement Village because we're talking to the post-war baby boomers today just to find out their thoughts about what they'd like to hear from the Chancellor. Elaine has been planking now for about... You can rest easy, you know. Bless her, she's been doing a plank for ages. And we've got Ron here as well. I'm going to have a quick chat to you because I know you have got some thoughts, haven't you, on what you would like to hear from the Chancellor today. What would you like him to...
We're the least likely to have any problems with the Chancellor. We're a privileged few, I'm afraid. But the thing I would like the most is that we've all got cash balances selling our other houses, yeah, and their interest rates are so poor that we do not get any return on the credit balances in our accounts. That's one of my main worries. And, of course, the car licence fees are likely to go up and we depend on our cars, although the buses are quite handy here, but I've no complaints.
So things like car tax and the interest rates.
Interest rates are the main things, so far as we're concerned. We are the privileged few here,
yeah.
In all fairness. We're the last people you should ask for budget changes.
And, I mean, it's fair to say you had a long-established career, didn't you, before you came here?
Tell us a bit. I was a junior clerk at 16 in 1943 in a bank and finished up as manager in Birmingham of the Bank of London and South America.
Yeah, and a former cricket player as well.
Well, I played professional cricket. I earned more money playing cricket on a Saturday than I did the rest of the week in the bank.
Did you?
Yeah, only for 9 or 10 years.
Yeah. Yeah. Ron, lovely to talk to you. And I know people don't like revealing their age, but can you just tell everyone how old you are? Because I think
89.
Everyone...
89.
And look at... I'm going to leave you to your weight, Ron.
This is not faking. I'm doing this on my own.
Yeah. I'd never expect you to fake, Ron. Thank you very much. We'll see you a little bit later on. But, yeah, it's really interesting to be here because, obviously, this is a retirement village, which is all about giving people like Ron and the other people here their independence. And there's lots of facilities here, something like 300 residents who live here as well, and it's in 1- and 2-bedroomed apartments. And we've got a couple of experts we can chat to, but come through here and have a look. It's dead nice here, isn't it? But let's go and have a chat to some of our guests. We've got Angela here, who's from HUK, and Elizabeth, who's from the University of Warwick. Angela, we were hearing Ron talking there about savings for older people, the fact that they don't get much money for their savings, and also he was talking about his car and how important that is to him and the cost of the car. Just paint that wider picture of the things that older people are worried about.
Well, there'll be around half of all older people who exist mainly living on the state pension of around £7,000 a year, and so they really don't have much wriggle room in their finances. And when you think about things like the government asking people to think about saving for care places or trying to plan for pensions, then really we've got to try and protect the incomes of older people so that they're able to spend when they need to on things like care and incomes.
And Elizabeth, you're an economist, so just explain to me, one of the things Ron was talking about there was he was saying he actually feels quite lucky because he feels like he has got money and feels better off than other people, younger people. Can you just explain that kind of difference as well? Because there are some young people who look at older people and think, well, look at them, they've got their nice homes and I can't even afford to buy a house.
Yeah, I think that is very much the case. And I think one thing in particular is the triple lock that we've seen on pensions, which has enabled pensioner income to increase more so than the working age population. So with the triple lock, it's guaranteeing the income of pensioners, it's rising. And if you look at the working age income, that's really when we've seen pay freezes and really very little increase in the working age income. And I think that's one of the things that's reduced the disparity in that income gap. And so I think some people of working age really are sort of looking at pensioners and are potentially sort of resenting the fact that their incomes have increased. But I think we also have to look at the wider picture in terms of the needs of the of pensioners, not just in terms of healthcare and social care, but just ensuring that they've got this sort of community feel. And I think this place like Bournville, I think, is a fantastic environment for pensioners. But I think there is this resentment. And I think we have to take the broader view of public finances as well, in terms of if we do want to improve the incomes of the working age population, you know, where is that money going to come from? Yeah. I think public finances are still in a very, very difficult position. And so I can't really see very much room for manoeuvre for Philip Hammond this afternoon. Perhaps something for social care, but I don't think we're going to see too many giveaways in the budget.
And what are your thoughts on that then about the fact that, you know, as we're hearing Elizabeth say, it is really tight, it's hard to give older people more.
There's more disparity amongst any generation than there are between the generations. And if you ask younger people what they would like to give money to, they will often say that they want it to be given to older people because they feel that they just don't have the flexibility to change their situation. There are certainly issues to do with housing and to do with transfer of wealth, but don't look to the poorest older people to fund the poorest younger people. Have a look at the wealth of the entire nation, the entire economy, and see what you can fund. Certainly an emergency cash injection for social care is what we'd be looking for, and then a longer term plan in how you would fund social care, because that's the kind of public service that matters for everybody, younger and older people.
Interesting, thank you. It's so complex, isn't it? He's got a tough job, the Chancellor, today. Thank you very much for your time. I'm going to be here talking to some more of the residents a little bit later. But questions about what they would like to hear from the budget today. Today we're talking to the post-war baby boomers and beyond. So I'm at a retirement village in Bournville.
Christmas. Morning, Steph.
Good morning to you. Morning, everybody. Welcome to Bournville Gardens. Lots of Carol Kirkwood fans here, I have to say. Morning, everyone.
Morning.
There we go. Very lively here this morning. But this retirement village has around 300 residents who live here. And we're talking to them today about what their thoughts are and what they'd like to hear from the Chancellor. We've got Keith, who's in charge of the pool table, the snooker table this morning, and the team over there in charge of the pool table and the darts going on as well. But there's lots going on here this morning because, as you say, every day we've been talking to different generations about what they would like to hear. Tim Moffat went to meet some of the baby, the post-war baby boomers and beyond at a walking club in North. Right, here we go.
Which one?
Oh, there we go. Your shot, Keith. Get the game finished. Come on, we're taking it. Brilliant. We're going to be talking, sorry, totally distracted by playing a game of snooker with Keith, and we've got darts going on here as well. But I'm going to be talking to the guys here about what they would like to hear from the Chancellor as well. We've got some experts to talk to as well, because obviously, you know, the difference, there's quite a lot of difference in terms of what people want. Some similarities, lots of people here talking about social care being a concern for them, but also them, lots of them worried about their grandchildren as well, and making sure they get onto the housing ladder and that type of thing. Right, I'm going to have a go at the darts now before I go. So can I have a shot? Come on then, cheers.
I'm right. Ready for you.
I'm not very good at it. Does everyone want to duck in case they get hit in the face?
I can bounce back.
Oh no. Not bad. High five, come on. Put it there.
Steph, thank you very much.
Morning. Good morning to you. Morning, everybody. Yeah, I'm at Bournville Gardens here. We have just in the gym, as you can see, a lot of action here this morning. And Maureen and Michael, you're helping your husband out, aren't you, on the machines? Yeah, not bossing him around, I hope.
Not too much.
Right, well, I'm going to take her away from here for 5 minutes, if that's all right, because we're going to have a chat and a little look around, if that's all right. Because we're talking today about the budget. Won't be long before we hear from the Chancellor. What would you like to hear from him?
Well, I'd like every old person to be able to have this sort of independent life we've got. Mm. We're here in Bournville Gardens. It's fine because we've got pensions, but for some people on ordinary retirement pensions, if they cut the care budget, then they're not going to be able to access care packages in the same way that we can here.
Yeah, that's made a big difference to you, hasn't it? Because you were a teacher for a long time, and yourself and your husband have both got good pensions.
Pensions, yes. But if you haven't got that and you rely on the care packages supplied by the National Health or government, it's not so easy to obtain. Yeah. And then it causes problems then with bed blocking, which we always get blamed for. But if the care packages were in place, it wouldn't happen. And I think that's something they shouldn't cut any more money from.
Yeah. So that's a big thing for you. I'm going to go and let you join your friends. We'll leave Michael to it. If he needs us, he'll shout warning. But let me show you around as well, because this is the lovely atrium here. And in it, we've got Marion, who has written a book about living better when you're older and the kind of help you need. We were hearing Maureen there talk about the pressures on social care. And she feels very lucky in what she's got, but would like to see more help for others so everyone can have that equal care as they're older. What is the kind of wider picture on what people are worried about in their late 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s?
Well, I think you're right. I think Maureen's right that people are worried, very worried at the moment about social care, because although all these people are doing all these wonderful, physical jerks and so on here, the fact is that people over the age of, say, 85, you know, the fifth of them will have dementia, and people are very worried about social care, and the funding of social care is crucial, and we need Philip Hammond to set in place some kind of sustainable system for the funding of social care, both for older people and also for younger disabled people. And this has huge ramifications. I mean, a couple of weeks ago, the BBC uncovered 23,000 cases of alleged abuse amongst home care workers in the UK. That's terrible. That's a national scandal. We have to address this. At the same time, I think older people are concerned about younger generations. They're concerned about the resentment that's building up against some of the so-called pensioner perks. You know, these universal benefits that were introduced like sort of election bribes by Gordon Brown that have no kind of real validity in them.
So and we worry of inequality then.
And we need to, you know, address those. You know, for instance, over the age of 65, you don't have to pay national insurance if you're working. Well, you know, should that actually continue in the future?
People are very different in terms of their wealth.
Some of them are very wealthy and some, of course, are poor. And we have to safeguard the position of poor people, whether they're young or old.
Yeah. Marion, thank you very much. There's a few other guests I want to just have a quick chat to as well, because we've got Angela here, who's from Age UK, and it's Elizabeth, who is an economist as well. Just your thoughts on what you want to hear and what we should be hearing to help people in this generation.
So
I think at the moment the main area that probably needs more funding is going to be social care. I think the Chancellor hasn't got that much room to manoeuvre, even though economic figures are a bit more positive. Borrowing is still very high for the financial year at around about 50 billion. But I think social care is probably the main area that needs extra funding.
Yeah. And what are your thoughts, Angela?
I'm afraid social care as well, so that's probably a hat trick. But we would like to have an immediate injection of cash and then a really long-term plan that helps to transform social care. That's for all generations, not just for older people today.
Not long until we find out what is in the budget a little bit later on. But I think we should get a goodbye from everyone. Are you up for a goodbye? One, two, three. Bye. Here we go. That's us at Bournville Gardens this morning.
Oh, isn't that lovely? Thank you very much, Steph. I think you might be staying there.